could come with grief and compassion. And he's so much overcome by sorrow that he composes a shloka, and it's, you know, he says a curse to the male. When he sees the male bird dying, he speaks out a curse in anger to the hunter. And as soon as he finishes, he realizes that he acknowledges that he accepts that he should not have done this. You know, he's a sage, he's a muni, and he should be self-controlled, and he should have restraint on his anger. And he's, you know, kind of overcome by a feeling of little bit of guilt that why did I curse the hunter in anger? And, you know, as soon as he finishes this thought, he also realizes that the curse actually came out in a perfect poetic meter, and it was an original composition. And understanding that, he begins to realize that maybe there is a higher power or providence behind this entire scene and his action of cursing the hunter. So I was listening to a class by Gaurang Prabhu, and he explains that this sets the scene for the beginning of composition of Ramayana. And he was explaining that many times in life we go through very difficult circumstances, and instead of being disheartened, we should take shelter of the Lord and understand that many of our scriptures have been given at the onset of some kind of a problem. Parikshit Maharaj was cursed to die in 7 days and seven nights, and that's how Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken. And at the battlefield of Kurukshetra, Arjuna was in a very despondent situation. In a, you know, he was feeling despair, and that's when Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna. And similarly, you know, this was not a very happy situation. Valmiki Muni saw the bird being killed by the hunter's arrow, and you know, a poetic expression came out, which was actually a curse. But this set the scene for the beginning of Ramayana. So he, Valmiki Muni, he goes back to his ashram, and he shares this incident with his disciple Bhardwaj Muni. And he's still looking for some kind of a guidance or instruction from a higher power or a higher authority of how he should go about this. And that's when Lord Brahma comes. And Lord Brahma explains to Valmiki Muni that you should propagate the glories of Lord Ram through Ramayana. And Valmiki Muni, you know, he submits and surrenders himself to Lord Brahma, to Brahmaji, and accepting his instruction, you know, in his heart, he decides to compose Ramayana. And after the composition is over, he teaches that to Love and Kush, who were residing in his ashram that time. And Love and Kush go around the planet, hearing, reciting, and giving reciting Ramayana, and giving other people an opportunity to hear about the glories of Lord Ram as well. And this is what is explained by Acharyas, that true relief from any kind of suffering in our life can come from when we hear and when we recite from our scriptures. So now we will, Ramayana, which was composed by Valmiki Muni, it's divided into seven parts, which are called seven khands. And it's 24,000 verses, and the entire composition is in the form of a poem. And, you know, I accept my inability to cover the entire, you know, the sequence of events, cannot do full justice in the next just 30 or 35 minutes. So we'll try to do the best. We'll pause in some places, maybe, you know, speeden up in other places, and then leave some room for question answers at the end. The story of Ramayan begins from the province of Kaushal. There's a river called Sarayu River that goes through that province. And around that is the kingdom of Ayodhya. Now, the kingdom of Ayodhya gets its name Ayodhya. Yodha means battle or yudh. Yudh means a war. And Ayodhya means that which has been undefeated. Undefeated in the last 60,000 years. And Ayodhya was undefeated for in the last 60,000 years because the king of Ayodhya or king of the province of Kaushal, Dashrath Maharaj, was a self-realized soul. He was God-conscious and he loved his subjects just like how a father would love his children. And because he was God-conscious, the demigods would shower their blessings. The Gandharvas would come and sing there. And that tract of land, that piece of land had the blessings from the Lord and the demigods. The seasons were very moderate. There were nice flowers and fruits. The place was well protected by Maharathis from all sides. Despite having such a nice situation, you know, the subjects loved Dashrath Maharaj. Dashrath Maharaj loved his, all the people in his kingdom. The place was protected. Seasons were moderate. They had nice crops. Everything was good. Despite that, Dashrath Maharaj had one frustration in his life. And that was that he did not have a son. Now, again, we have to understand that this frustration is not just, a couple without a child would have. It was as a king, it was his duty to have a son who can take care of the kingdom and the subjects after he leaves his body. Gaurang Prabhu was explaining in his lecture that this is also the nature of the material world actually. Ayodhya also, although this was a very special part of planet Earth, but because it was in the material world, it was not independent or free from the problems of the material world. And even though everything else might be perfect, still there will be something that will cause a frustration or that will cause frustration, that will frustrate the living entity. Because of this concern, Dashrath Maharaj, he decided to perform a yagna. And sage Rishi Shinga was invited. Rishi Shinga is actually the husband of Shanta. Dashrath Maharaj, he did not have a son, but he had a daughter by the name Shanta. And he had given Shanta to his friend Romapad Maharaj, who did not have a child. And Shanta was adopted by Romapad Maharaj, and she was married to a sage Rishi Shinga. And I don't want to take the detour, but Rishi Shinga was a very powerful sage. He came from a very strong brahmachari background. He was in a forest where female species was not allowed in any form. Like there were no females at all, no female animals, no bugs, nothing. And after some time, he came out of that forest, he got married to Shanta. And he had performed a yagna for Romapad Maharaj when Romapad Maharaj's kingdom was stricken by drought. And then he was invited by Dashrath Maharaj to perform yagna. And he performed two yagnas. He performed a Ashwamedha yagna and he also performed a Putra Treshti yagna. And as part of this yagna, Dashrath Maharaj and his wives, they honored prasadam. There was a like a pot of payasam after the yagna, and Rishi Shinga distributed it to the three principal queens of Dashrath Maharaj. He had 353 queens, and the three principal queens were Kaushalya, Kaikeyi, and Sumitra. So he gave half piece, half portion of that payasam or sweet rice to Kaushalya. He gave one fourth to Kaikeyi and he gave 1/8 to Sumitra, and then he gave another 1/8 portion to Sumitra, and the rest was distributed. So soon after, Kaushalya Devi, Kaikeyi and Sumitra were expecting, and then they gave birth. Kaushalya gave birth to a son, Kaikeyi gave birth to a son, and Sumitra gave birth to twins, two boys. And after 13 days, Vasishtha Muni, he performed the name-giving ceremony, the name-giving samskara. Kaushalya's son was given the name Ram, and Kaikeyi's son was given the name Bharat, and Sumitra's sons were called Lakshman and Shatrughna. So when they were born, initially they were paired, was how they were paired is Ram and Bharat were kept together in the bassinets, and Lakshman and Shatrughna were kept together. And Lakshman kept crying and Shatrughna also kept crying, and they would not stop crying at all. So at Vasishtha Muni's suggestion, Lakshman was brought close to Ram in his bassinet, and Shatrughna was brought close to Bharat. And that's when Lakshman and Shatrughna stopped crying and they were pacified. So from very early on, they had chosen their masters. It was clear that Lakshman likes to serve Ram, and Shatrughna likes to serve Bharat. So as I had mentioned earlier, that Valmiki Ramayana has 24 khands. The first one is Balakanda, and the growing up of boys is covered in detail in the Balakanda. One, you know, the four boys, the four divine personalities, you know, they appeared as human beings. They were going through their education and their learnings with military warfare. And around the time when Lord Ram was 15, 16 years old, that time, Vishwamitra Muni came to the palace of Dashrath Maharaj. And Vishwamitra Muni is a self-realized soul. Dashrath Maharaj was very happy when he came. He gave him a place on his throne, and that was the etiquette in those days. The king would come down and he would offer the highest place in his kingdom, which was his throne, to the sage. And he said that, it is my desire to please you. Please ask me whatever you want, I will provide, and it will give me great satisfaction and great happiness by serving you. Vishwamitra Muni said that, I have my hermitage, my ashram in the forest, and we perform yagnas. And there are demons, rakshasas, who come there. They contaminate the place with blood and stool and urine and pus and all kinds of pollutants. And they're creating a havoc every time we try to perform a yagna. So I want your son, Ram, to come with me to help me kill these demons. So as soon as Dashrath Maharaj heard that, his heart sank. And Vishwamitra Muni went on to further explain that these demons are associates of Ravan. Ravan himself does not come, but he sends these rakshasas to create a disturbance in our yagna. So when Dashrath Maharaj heard the word Ravana, he got a bigger shock after that. Because Ravana was known around the world as a very cruel demon that time. And Lord Ram was still just like a 15, 16-year-old boy who had not even finished his military education. So Maharaj Dashrath, he started crying and he started pleading to Vishwamitra Muni that I cannot give Ram. Like, how can I give you Ram for like 10 days or 14 weeks? I cannot survive even a moment if Ram is not in front of me. Like, even a moment's separation from Ram is not tolerable. So I don't know how I will survive for 2 weeks. And you're talking of, demons, demon associates of Ravana. Ram has not even finished his education yet. So I'll come with you I'll take my soldiers, we'll take millions of soldiers, as many Akshahonis as you want, and I will fight with Ravan. I will fight with the demons. And Vishwamitra Muni started getting very upset. He was very angry. And Lord, that time, Dashrath Maharaj's family priest, who is Vasishtha Muni, he comes. And he tries to pacify Dashrath Maharaj. And he explains that Vishwamitra Muni has a Kshatriya background himself. He is now a Brahman. But he has enough armor and tools and weapons in his possession. He actually has enough Brahman Tejas to kill all the demons by himself. If he is asking for your son, there is a reason behind it. And by doing this, he is trying to bring glory to your son. If he wants, he can kill the demons himself. And he also explained that Vishwamitra Muni has many weapons which were given to him by demigods. If needed, he can make use of those to protect Ram. But if you do not send Ram with him, he is going to get really angry and he is going to destroy everything. And Vishwamitra Muni actually in anger was saying that this is the first time in Raghukul that somebody has made a promise and they will not honor it. So, you know, there was, after listening to Vasishtha Muni's guidance, Dashrath Maharaj, he agreed to send Ram with Vishwamitra Muni. And of course, you know, wherever Ram goes, Lakshman follows. So when they were going, Lord Ram on his way to Vishwamitra Muni's hermitage, he killed the first demon, Tadka. And there were two more demons on the way that he killed. So after they reached the hermitage, Vishwamitra Muni, he sat down with other sages to perform the yagna. For the next 10 days, it was peaceful, nothing happened. But when the yagna completed and it was time for the nectar to be distributed, that's when two demons, Maricha and Subahu, appeared. And you know, Lord Ram took the instruction and the cue from Vishwamitra Muni and he aimed to kill these two. Now, he killed Subahu with his arrow, but Lord Ram did not kill Maricha because Maricha had to perform. He knew that Maricha has to perform another important service in the future. He released his arrow in a very controlled way, in such a way that the arrow came and struck Maricha in his chest. But instead of being killed, he was actually shot out 800 miles away and into an island. And the place where Maricha fell actually is the island of Mauritius now. So after this, Vishwamitra Muni, Lord Ram and Lakshman, they go to various holy places. And there is also a pastime where they go to Gautam Rishi's hermitage and he delivers Ahalya from, you know, there was a stone there. Again, we won't take the detour because it will take a long time, but there was a stone there and Lord Ram, when he touched that stone, the stone assumed the original form of a beautiful lady, Ahalya, who had been cursed and who had taken the form of a stone. In this way, they keep going further. And Vishwamitra Muni takes Lord Ram and Lakshman to the kingdom of Janak Maharaj, the land of Mithila. At that point, Janak Maharaj, he is discussing with Vishwamitra Muni. And in Janak Maharaj's palace, there was this very special bow. It was actually a bow of Lord Shiva, which Lord Shiva had used when there was a tussle between him and Daksha, and it had actually gone to Devavrat in Raghukul dynasty, and then it came to Janak Maharaj, and after that it stayed with Janak Maharaj in Mithila. This celestial bow of Lord Shiva was extremely heavy, and No, ordinarily, nobody could move it. You needed like 500 men, strong-bodied soldiers to even move that bow. It was stationed in a very special jeweled case in Janak Maharaj's palace. And Janak Maharaj, wanting his daughter was Sita Devi, the eternal consort of Lord Ram. Janak Maharaj, Gaurang Prabhu was explaining in his class that he wanted to train Sita Devi in all aspects of devotional service and train her well. So even though she was a little kid, cleaning the palace was her chore or her duty. And one day she was cleaning the palace, and as part of her regular cleaning routine, she came across that jeweled case which had the special celestial bow. And in an attempt to clean, she just picked up the case with her left hand and took the broom and cleaned under the case and around the case and put the bow down. And Janak Maharaj was very astonished when he saw that. Because ordinarily nobody could even lifting it. It couldn't even be moved easily. He decided that just so that her future husband does not suffer from an inferiority complex, only that person can marry Sita who is able to lift this bow and string this bow. And in the last many years, several kings and princes from many dynasties and kingdoms came and they attempted, but nobody could, you know, forget stringing the bow or lifting the bow. They could not even move it. So Vishwamitra Muni suggested that, why don't you have Lord Ram take a look at the bow? So in the palace of Janak Maharaj, amidst the assembly of, all his ministers, Lord Ram, he approached the celestial bow. He paid obeisances to the bow. He looked at Vishwamitra Muni and took his blessings. And taking the cue and the nod and the blessings from Vishwamitra Muni, with his left hand, he picked up the bow of Lord Shiva. And as soon as he did that, there was like a loud thundering and clapping by all the residents. And then in the next moment, he took the string and with his right hand, he strung the bow. And then he bent it, and he bent it in such a way that it cracked in the middle. And as soon as it cracked, other than Janak Maharaj, Vishwamitra Muni, Lord Ram, and Lakshman, everybody else in the assembly became unconscious. Everybody fainted. And Janak Maharaj was very happy, when this happened, because finally somebody had been able to lift it and string it. He was worried that maybe he was too fast or too quick in making that decision. And he was worried, what if nobody is able to do that and my daughter Sita cannot get married because of the vow I took. But when this happened, he heaved a sigh of relief. And as had been promised, he decided to give hand of Sita in marriage to Lord Ram. And Lord Ram said, oh, wait, hold it. I was asked to lift the bow and string the bow. Nobody spoke about marriage. So you're talking of marriage. My parents need to be here. So messengers left for Ayodhya. And the Bharat party or the marriage party came from Ayodhya to Mithila. And Lord Ram, in a very nice, grand celebration, was married to his eternal consort, Mother Sita. And that at that time, Mother Sita's younger sister, Mandodari, and her two cousins, Shruti Kirti, were also married. So four divine personalities, Lord Ram, Bharat, Lakshman, and Shatrughan, were married to Sita, Mandodari, Shruti Kirti. Sister of Mother Sita and two cousins of Mother Sita. Janak Maharaj's younger brother also had two daughters and they were married to Bharat and Shatrughna. And in this way, they all came back to Ayodhya. On the way, they had met Parshuram, and Parshuram was really angry and upset because Lord Ram had broken the bow of Lord Shiva. So he had a bow of Lord Vishnu, and he confronted Lord Ram, and Lord Ram's father Dasharatha Maharaj, he got again very anxious that Parshuram is so angry and Ram is just a young boy. How is Ram going to face this angry Parshuram? And Lord Ram pacified his father. He took the bow of Lord Vishnu from Parshuram's hand and he strung it and he brought it close to his ear and he asked Parshuram, where should I release this arrow now? And this is again a very rare pastime in our scriptures where two incarnations are standing face to face to each other. Lord Ram and everybody else, you know, after finishing the celebration and after taking care of Parshuram, they came back to the city of Ayodhya. All the Ayodhya residents were very happy, very jubilant. Everybody loved Ram much more than they loved their own children. And Lord Ram, in reciprocation, loved all the subjects and the Ayodhya residents very dearly. And while this was going on, demigods are thinking, you know, they were thinking of 4.7 and 4.8 also, that the Lord has gone down to get onto the case of Ravana. And if all these goody-goody, happy-happy things keep going in Ayodhya, how and when is Lord going to come out of Ayodhya, get to Lanka and take care of Ravana? So because of this, they were getting, you know, they just wanted to accelerate things. And they were actually the demigods were worried that if this goody-goody thing continues, you know, Lord Ram is with Mother Sita, his eternal consort. They are in Ayodhya. Ayodhya is a very happy place. It's almost like a spiritual world. All the Ayodhya residents love him. He loves the Ayodhya residents. There's no impetus, no need to, you know, step out now. And the Lord is just going to forget about his mission. And they decided to accelerate things a little bit. Dasharatha Maharaj wanted Lord Ram to become the prince regent, which means that after Dasharatha Maharaj leaves his body, Lord Ram should become the king. And he called all his subjects and he called all his ministers and he said that I want to coronate Ram as the prince regent or the crown prince. And I'm not seeing very nice omens. I'm seeing inauspicious signs. So I don't want to wait too much because I think there could be impediments. Let's do it tomorrow. At this time, Bharat and Shatrughna were at Bharat's maternal place in the land of Kekai, which is in present-day Russia. Now, what had happened was Kekai, actually, Dasharatha Maharaj's second principal queen, was much younger in age as compared to him. And when Dasharatha Maharaj had asked her hand in marriage, Kekai's father said that, I will marry my daughter to you only on one condition, that her son will become the king. So Dasharatha Maharaj gave a promise that time, but now he wanted Ram to become the king. So he thought that I should coronate Ram as the crown prince while Bharat is away in his maternal land. And he did not want to postpone at all. He said, let's do it tomorrow. So as the news spread, all the Ayodhya residents were very happy. All three mothers, Kekai, Sumitra, Kaushalya, were very happy. There was one person in the kingdom of Ayodhya who was unhappy, and that was Manthara. Manthara was Kekai's maidservant. Manthara was unhappy because she was thinking like this. Kekai's son is Bharat and Ram is Kaushalya's son. I am the maid servant of Kekai. If Ram becomes the king, then his mother Kaushalya is at a higher position than Kekai. And if my master Kekai is in a lower position, then my position is not a very good position. My position is threatened. So because of this separatist mentality and envy and jealousy, he was feeling very insecure, very insecure. And Warren Prabhu was explaining in his lecture that Bhagavad Gita also begins with this kind of a separate mentality. When Dhritarashtra said, on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, what did my sons and the sons of Pandu do? So he was seeing, you know, these are my children and these are the sons of Pandu, and what did they do? So generally, that separatist mentality or envy or jealousy is the cause of a conflict. So up until now, everything was very good. But now we are seeing the separatist mentality of Manthara, and her envy and her jealousy is going to give rise to a conflict. So Manthara approaches Kaikeyi. And Kaikeyi actually was very happy because she loved Ram dearly. And Manthara tells Kaikeyi, do you know what is happening here in Ayodhya? Do you have any idea? And Kaikeyi said, yeah, everything is good. I don't know what you are talking about. Are you referring to something specific? And Manthara says that Ram is going to be coronated as the crown prince tomorrow. And Kaikeyi said, yes, that's a very good news. Actually, the messenger who brought this news, I was so happy. I gave her my very dear necklace and precious jewels. And Manthara bangs her head. And she's like, are you a fool? Like, don't you see things as they are? And she tells Kaikeyi that if Ram becomes the king, Bharat cannot become the king. Bharat, your son, cannot become the king. And Kaikeyi says, no problem, Manthara. If Ram becomes the king, then Bharat can become the king once Ram's term is over. And Manthara says, no. When Ram's term is over, Ram's son will become the king. Bharat will not become the king. And Kaikeyi says, that's fine. That's okay. And I was listening to a lecture by my Guru Maharaj, and he said that a person who's satisfied in love of God or in a service of God is actually firm in their faith. But Maya does not give up that easily. She'll come in different forms and she'll try to shake your faith. So Manthara tried two times. It did not work. She said, your son Bharat will not become the king. Kaikeyi was unwavered. She said, Ram's son will become the king. Kaikeyi was still unwavered. Now she tries the third time in a different spin. And she says, if Ram becomes the king, Kaushalya will be the principal mother. And you will be in a lower position. You will become Kaushalya's servant. You will be Kaushalya's maid servant. You will always play second fiddle to her. Is that what you want? And now Kaikeyi started thinking in the same mentality as Manthara was thinking. This is the power of association. You know, next Sunday's class will be focused more on teachings based off different pastimes of Lord Ramayan. But it's a very important concept. Like, if we become whatever we associate with, there's a very powerful saying in English. Tell me who your friends are, and I can tell what kind of a person you are. Whatever we associate with, we become like that. And my Guru Maharaj, very often he quotes this, that if you touch an iron rod that has been placed in fire, you will get burnt by that iron rod in exactly the same fashion how you would get burnt by putting your hand into the fire. By the power of fire, by the association of fire, the iron rod has become as hot as the fire itself. So Kaikeyi, although her original position was that of loving Lord Ram, by associating with Manthara, was totally corrupted to the point that she started asking Kaikeyi, okay, I admit there is a problem. What are you proposing? What's your solution? Take a look on the time here. Okay. What are you proposing? What's the solution? And Manthara says that you were promised two boons. Lord Dashrath Maharaj gave you two promises many years ago, and you still haven't asked for those. So this is the time to get those two fulfilled. Ask Maharaj Dashrath to make Bharat the king, and banish Ram into exile for 14 years. And, you know, so she convinces Kaikeyi to do that. We're running out of time here. You know, we have 15 more minutes. I'm going to rush a little bit now. Lord Ram, so Mantra convinces Kaikeyi, and Kaikeyi, she goes into a sulking chamber, and Dashrath Maharaj, when he comes, you know, he comes looking for her, and he's informed by one of her maid servants that she's in the sulking chamber. So he goes there, and he asks her what is the matter. And, you know, she's taken off her jewelry, and she's, you know, her hair is open, and she's on the floor sulking. And she tells Dashrath Maharaj that I want these two things. And listening to this, Dashrath Maharaj becomes unconscious and he collapses on the floor. And when he comes back to consciousness, he pleads and he begs, but he's completely unmoved. Lord Ram, he comes looking for his father. And when he enters their chamber, she says that your father wants to tell you something, but he does not have the strength to tell you. So I want to tell you, but I'll tell you if you give me a promise that you will follow. And Dashrath Maharaj, you know, again, he becomes unconscious and he falls on the floor. And Lord Ram tells Mother Kaikeyi that, you know, I would have followed even if it came from my father. So please go ahead. You have my promise that I will follow whatever you ask me to do. And Kaikeyi says that Bharat will be coronated as the crown prince. And your father wants you to go into the forest for exile for 14 years. And listening to this, Lord Ram, without any hesitation, says that I'm happy to do it. I'm willing to do it. And I will execute on this. I will follow the instruction. I will leave for the forest. He leaves the room. He goes and informs his mother. And she's heartbroken. And she cries. And she tells Lord Ram that your father gave you an instruction to leave for the forest. And one of your duties to follow what your father is asking you to do. And, but I'm your mother and it is your duty as my son to take care of your old mother. So you should follow this instruction and you should take me with you. And Lord Ram, you know, Lakshman was also there that time. Lord Ram convinces her that, you know, you should stay with your husband here in this palace. And Lakshman and others will take care of you. And Lakshman immediately says, you are not, he was actually very angry. You are not going anywhere. Our father in this old age has been overcome by lust for Kaikeyi. And I'm going to kill everybody who opposes your coronation tomorrow. And if needed, I will kill my father also. Lord Ram, he chastises Lakshman mildly. He pacifies Lakshman. He pacifies his mother. Takes his mother's blessings and permission to leave. And he goes and informs. He goes to the chambers of Mother Sita to inform her. As soon as she hears that, she says that I want to come with you to the forest. Now, Lord Ram gave several reasons why she should not come with him to the forest. He says that you were raised as a princess by Dashrath Maharaj. All your life you have lived in palace. You have slept on soft beds, as soft as feather. You have eaten the most tastiest of the delicacies. You've been protected. You lived in the palace. I don't know where I will be living in the forest. There will be scorpions, snakes. There'll be demons and rakshasas. I'll be eating only fruits and roots and berries. There'll be thorns everywhere. It's not safe for you to come to the forest with me. And she tries to convince him through several ways. She says that when I was a child, an astrologer predicted that I will live in the forest. And, I like being in forest. I like the mountains and the rivers and everything. And he's still not convinced. So finally, she says that if you do not take me, I will commit suicide. And he's actually still not convinced and to take her. And she says that my father promised at the time of marriage that I will be by your side at all times. Do not turn my father into a liar. And saying this, she breaks down. And then Lord Ram, he picks her up and he says, okay, you come with me. And Lakshman says, I'm coming with you too. And Lord Ram offered him that you stay here, take care of our mothers. You serve Bharat. You know, Bharat will be the king. He will need assistance. And Lakshman says that Shatrughan will be there to take care of our mothers and to take care of Bharat. I'm coming with you. So they proceed. And when they're getting ready to leave, Dashrath Maharaj is in an uncontrollable state. And he tells Ram that don't go like this. Don't go alone. I will come with you. We will take some wealth. We will take some merchants with us. We will take some supplies. We'll take some few things from the treasury. And that point, Kaikeyi steps in. Kaikeyi says that now Bharat is the crown prince. And Bharat is the future king of Ayodhya. You cannot take anything from the state of Ayodhya without Bharat's permission. It's not allowed. So when Lord Ram listens to this, he decides to give up his royal garments and his jewels and his ornaments. He donates everything to the Brahmanas. And he decides to wear tree bark. And Kaikeyi personally brings tree bark for Lord Ram to wear. And she brings tree bark for Mother Sita also. And, you know, when she did that, all the ministers and all the Ayodhya residents were crying. They just could not see, you know, Lord Ram taking off everything, donating and putting on tree bark. Mother Sita actually was struggling a lot. She just could not figure out how to wear the tree bark. And Lord Ram, looking at her in this state, he said, just put it on top of your sari. So she just puts the tree bark on the top of the sari and they leave. They leave Ayodhya. And Ayodhya residents in love for Lord Ram, they start following. Lord Ram is on the chariot. Lord Ram, Mother Sita, Lakshman are on the chariot with Sumantra. And all the Ayodhya residents are following. And Ayodhya residents, they said, Ayodhya is where Ram is. You are going into the forest. We will come with you. We will come with you to the forest. The forest is going to turn into Ayodhya. And this city which we are leaving behind is going to become a forest. And Kaikeyi can stay here with her son in the forest. And this will become Banvas. And Lord Ram was not happy with that. He told everybody that you should stay here. And they leave. And, you know, many Brahmanas, many sages, many Ayodhya Vasis were still following Lord Ram. And he felt bad that, you know, he was on the chariot and these people, you know, many of them were old. They were running. They were trying to catch up with him. And he decides to step down from the chariot. And they just start walking. Time now is 4:52. I'm going to do is I'm going to pause here. We are going to continue next Sunday. Unmuting everybody. If there are any questions or comments, we can take it in time. And part two of Ramayana will be covered next Sunday.
क्या कर रही है काशिका छोड़ दो
रनिंग प्लेस कर लिए थे रनिंग प्लेस किए थे डैडी
क्वेश्चन पूछ रहा है So everybody is on mute now. If you have a question, you have the control to unmute.
Oh, Dad.
I wanted to ask, but that she is...
Everybody is muted, but whoever has a question can unmute yourself.
Amrit Kelly.
Yes, Mataji.
Yeah, I mean, I was listening. Class was very nice, everything nice. Only one thing that not Mandodari, but Urmila is the sister of...
Yes, Urmila. Yes, Mandodari was Ravana's wife.
Yeah, yeah, but Urmila, you were you were saying Mandodari. So
I misspoke. Oh, thank you for catching that.
Oh, you're welcome. No problem.
Yeah. Anybody else has a question? Comment? Any comment?
I think everybody's muted.
Okay, we are going to unmute everybody. There will be some background noise, but if you have a question or comment, you can speak.
Those who are muted are by the way.
Okay, if there are no questions, we have 5 minutes. I can continue with the story. We'll continue. So Lord Ram, Mata Sita, Lakshman, they came out of the outskirts of Ayodhya and they reached a place which was under the rule of Maharaj Guha. Maharaj Guha was the king of the Nishada race. They were the boatman community. They reached, Maharaj Guha said that you become the king of my kingdom. And I will be your servant. And I want you to take the control and the ownership. And you stay here. And Lord Ram said that, no, I cannot do that. Maharaj, his family, they prepared a very nice offering for the pleasure of Lord Ram. And they brought it. But Lord Ram said that I cannot access. I can only take suits. So you this chapan bhog to my horses. He just took some fruits and really simple prasadam, and then he wanted to cross the river. So he told Maharaj Guha that I want to ride in your boat and go on to the other side of the river. Maharaj Guha said that before I let you get onto my boat, I want to wash your feet. And Lord Ram said, why do you want to wash my feet? Maharaj Guha said that I have heard a story where you put your feet on a rock and by the power of the dust of your lotus feet, that rock turned into a very beautiful woman. Now, I have a wife at home. If you step on my boat and my boat turns into a woman and if I take her home, my wife will kill me. So he washed the feet of Lord Ram and he sprinkled on his head. He sprinkled it on that water on the head of all his family members and his subjects. And he saved that water, that Charnamrit, and he honored it every day as when he honored Prasadam. This last time of Lord Ram leaving Maharaj Guha's kingdom. And after leaving from there, after crossing the river, they reached the hermitage of Bhardwaj Rishi. And it was a very nice ashram. And Bhardwaj Rishi, he welcomed Lord Ram. And he requested Lord Ram to stay there. And Lord Ram, and the mood and the thoughts of Bhardwaj Muni, but he said that, "This place, your place is too close to Ayodhya. If I stay here, then Mother Kaikeyi will not like it. So I need to go deeper into the forest. So can you please suggest a place?" And that's when Bhardwaj Muni suggested that 100 miles from here into the interior of the forest is a place called Chitrakoot. And Chitrakoot is the place where Lord Ram, Mother Sita and Lakshman went, and they actually spent 13 years of their 14 year exile in Chitrakoot. It's only after they had moved to Panchvati that action of Shruprakha and Ravan and Karan Dushan coming. So I think it's 5 p.m. now. It's a good stopping point. With Lord Ram reaching Chitrakoot, we have covered the Balakanda and the Ayodhya Kand, and now the Aranya Kand is going to start next Sunday. So again, if anybody has a question or comment, you can either unmute yourself or use the chat feature. Chat feature has 4 comments here. Chat feature, are you looking at the chat feature?
Yeah, no.
Okay.
Are we having Aarti at all in the Zoom, Amrit Keli?
No, Mataji. No, only class. It's difficult to focus the camera with the Aarti. So only classes, only online classes, no Aarti.
In our Irvine group, they're doing Aarti also, you know, on Friday nights when we have the Bhagavad Gita class. In one home, they're doing Aarti, yeah.
No, Mataji, we have only class here. But we have noted the suggestion.
Thank you.
Yeah. Should we stop now? No more questions?
Yeah. I think we can stop. Yeah. Hari Bol.
Thank you so much, Amrit Keli. Nice Ram Katha.
Yes, thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Hare
Krishna.
Okay. Srila Prabhupada ki.
Jai.
Lord Ram, Mother Sita, Lakshman, Hanuman ji ki.
Jai.
Premanande.
Hare Hare Bol.
Jai.